Thank you. Thank you so much, and welcome everybody. It's a pleasure to be with you, with my avatar, and to actually have this conversation with Ricardo. Ricardo is an entrepreneur, innovator, and someone actually who's worked in the higher education entrepreneurship space for many years. And it's a pleasure to have this conversation with you, Ricardo. So let's start with a quick introduction. And I think that many of you have seen Ricardo's bio, being a co-founder and board member of Beta I, working with the Lisbon Challenge, and the international setting up the International Startup Acceleration Program for Growth, and also working on the European Innovation Academy and Singularity Portugal. So a lot of very interesting activities. So let's start from the beginning, Ricardo. Tell us a little bit about the European Innovation Academy. I know that you worked a lot with schools, and I know that this is one of the projects that has already been concluded, but I think it's very interesting to learn more about your experience in working with youth inside the university, and how did that go?
Yeah, thanks, Ayman. Can you hear me? Hello?
We can hear you.
Yes, we can hear you.
Yeah, okay. So the European Innovation Academy was a project that we brought to Portugal about 3 years ago, well, 4 years ago. And the idea was really, how can we create like an accelerator of mindset for the youth? Taking into account that we gather university students in a room, and the world is more and more global. So it's very important to have all sorts of people in the room. So typically an innovation academy is a 3-week journey where you put 500 students from different backgrounds, different geographies, to work together. And typically on the first day, they meet in teams of five. They don't know each other. And they have 3 weeks to actually go from one idea that they have on the first day to actually developing an MVP, a minimum viable product, launching the product, getting clients, and then presenting to investors, all in 3 weeks. And now, taking into account that the five people in the team, they don't know each other on the first day. So, and they come from, it could be an American, a European, an Asian, an African, all together with maybe a designer, an engineer, an economist, all sorts of backgrounds. And they have to come up to a way of working together with knowing that they come from different backgrounds and different cultures. So that means the first week is a mess. First week, everyone fights, everyone argues, everyone, you know, you have the European, okay, we got to go. We have only, I mean, it's a bit, I'm trying to give you just an idea of what happens in the room. But basically, the American will go, okay, we have 3 weeks, we got to go, and we have to have a solid MVP by the end of this week. And the Asian comes and says, oh, well, you know, I've been thinking, and maybe I'll give you an answer of my opinion tomorrow. And the American flips and says, no, we got to go now, we have to move. And then the European goes like, okay, we have to find a consensus. You know, all these cliches that we typically see, they actually happen a lot of times. And this replicated by 100 teams, it's amazing to see. The first week to the last week, the growth that these kids have over the 3 weeks, and the change of mindset that they have on the way to solve problems, on the way to understand each other, on the way to understand where the other person is coming from, and try to find the consensus so that the project moves forward. It's amazing. And so I think this project has really brought a lot of an interesting success to Portugal. Also because, I mean, I'm Portuguese, I wanted to have this program in Portugal. I wanted also to bring in a lot of Portuguese students into this world. A lot of these kids at university in Portugal, a lot of them, it's their first experience with really such an international bunch of people. And a lot of times they, maybe they never left the country, or they did, but they don't have a lot of experience outside. So this opens up the world to them. And from there, I've seen so many students come to me after and saying, what I experienced at the European Innovation Academy opened my eyes to do so many things and want to meet the, know more about the world. I got like five more couches around the world where I can sleep and have friends.
Ricardo, this is very interesting. We're seeing a lot of those types of programs that are about getting teams of students together, looking at a real life problem, trying to create a venture around it, and going through the whole process. We're seeing a lot of those programs pop up in different universities. We've done one at AUC, several of those actually over the past 10 years, and I see them popping up, but I rarely see them becoming an integral part of the curriculum and the educational process. And since most of the people that we have in the room here at are educators, I wanted to get your thoughts on this. Are those types of programs actually becoming, or should they be, an integral part of the academic programs? How much should they be, or how much weight should they have there? Are the programs, the learning that we're getting from traditional classroom courses, actually comparable to the kind of learning and personal growth and experience that students are getting from programs like the European Innovation Academy and the many similar programs? What are your thoughts on this? And I want to pose this actually as a challenge for most of the educators in the room. Why aren't those programs more prominent in our educational curricula, carrying credit, happening more frequently, organized as part of the day-to-day work of our universities, given the huge impact that they have on the students' personal character and also knowledge growth?
Yeah, I mean, this program actually has credits, and Nova is one of the partners, and they have a partnership to provide the credits for all the students. And I think, like you said, I do think these kinds of programs are very important because they provide you more than just the knowledge. They provide you the experience and I remember just before this, we had Daniel Trasa talking, and I remember a chat that we had, and he was telling me that why build a campus when they were building the Nova campus. And actually, it's not about the content. It's about the meeting, the exchange of knowledge that you do with your fellow students, and the friendships that will last for your lifetime. And I think these kinds of programs like the European Innovation Academy provide you a different layer in a fast way to really understand what is the thing that you like, or what is the thing maybe that you don't like, but you will experience something that will provide you something that you will carry for a lifetime. I mean, it's very, very intense. Just for you to understand, they start super early. They finish when they believe they have finished. So a lot of times they do all-nighters, especially at the end. And they're so bonded during that period that kind of experience comes from, for instance, when in a university you're doing a project together with a team. But I think because it's so short and intense, it provides you the enough change of mindset that will help you to think in a different way. And so I really think the weight of these programs should be bigger at universities, also because the way that universities have been teaching over the last 100 years, I mean, it's again a cliche. I think So many people have spoken about this, but it's true. I mean, universities have to change, have to introduce new experiences, and it can't be just, we are already experimenting. There has to be a moment where that experience passes into the curriculum and it becomes part of that curriculum. Otherwise, it's always going to be an experience, and it's something we do on the side just because it's. It reminds me the. Just to give an analogy, it reminds me when we started working at Betty with startups and corporates. And at the time, 2010, a lot of the corporates were coming to us and looking at the startups. And it felt like the corporates needed to be seen as innovative and be seen as, oh, we're working with startups. And in the end, nothing was really happening. It's more like we need to be perceived as, it's more like a communication kind of thing, but we're past that. And now universities are doing that with these kinds of programs. It means they're experimenting a lot of these small things, but I don't know how much of it is really the university thinking. I mean, down to earth, will the university change its method of learning, of teaching, so that parts of these experiments become part of that curriculum? And it's so important that the universities understand that we are past the moment where you have to experiment and then you show off by saying, oh, yes, we're experimenting with blockchain or AI or doing these programs with different, maybe entrepreneurship or something like this. This has to become part of it. So I don't know if I answered your question.
I think this is fantastic. This is exactly what I was looking at, which is encouraging universities to heavily incorporate programs like these in the curriculum, thinking about the experience, thinking about the interdisciplinary thinking, thinking about the cultural interaction, thinking about the growth in personality and character, as well as the learning. I think when you put all of these things together and you look at programs like these, the value that they bring to the curriculum is fantastic.
And yeah, I mean, if I can just add one thing. Last week I was at 42, which is a school that was started in Paris by Xavier Niel and a few other people. And I was talking with a few students there. It's like a coding school, but it's interesting because there's no teachers, there's no classes. And I was speaking with one of the students there, and he was telling me, look, I arrived here, we're 150 guys and girls in the room, and I didn't know anyone. And you arrive, there's a computer in front of me, I get a challenge, and the first thing I do is, hey, hi, my name is Ricardo, what's your name? So I talk to my colleague next to me, the fellow student. And they go like, okay, can you help me on this challenge? And maybe that person can help you a little bit. And then the next person, suddenly in a few days, you already know most of the people and you're engaging to try to solve the challenges that are being thrown at you by engaging with the power of the group and knowing the knowledge that each one has to advance on that challenge. And it's so powerful. The student was saying, like, this is amazing because there's nobody talking to us and we have to listen. No, we have to find a solution. And if I don't engage with other people, if I don't search for the information, if I don't try to go by myself, I'll just drown here. And so these kinds of learning processes are so important nowadays. And I just wanted to add this example.
That's fantastic. And I think that's important for us to think about it. Ricardo, let me jump to your experience at Beta I, Portuguese nonprofit association that you co-founded since 2010. You work a lot with companies, large corporations in different capacities on innovation programs. And at universities, we've been talking about bringing real life problems to the classroom, creating industry collaboration with academia, kind of connecting more our research and our learning with actual real life problems that are happening outside in the real world in those companies. And you work a lot on corporate innovation. If you can tell us a little bit about your experience there, some examples of companies or problems that you worked on, and how do we set up this those types of programs within universities to enhance those connections. At AUC, at the American University in Cairo, we're working on creating our innovation hub, which connects a platform to connect corporate to the university, and would love to hear from your experience in building those types of platforms.
Yeah, sure. I mean, we've started Betty in 2010, and in 2013, we really started engaging with corporates because they asked us, seeing what we were doing with the startups and the accelerators, how can we bring these methodologies inside the corporation? So we started an innovation area that today is our core business at PTE. And we have about 150 corporate clients in about 20 countries, and we engage in a lot of different industries. We do about 20 programs a year, and it's very active and very fast. Now, the evolution of these corporate programs has been at the beginning very like idea stage or even prototype stage startups or innovators that would bring in their possible solutions for challenges that the corporates were having. Over the years, we've seen that, and even today, corporates want to find solutions that are more or less immediate or in the coming months. And they can't really wait for an MVP or a prototype to evolve over the years and solve a problem. That means that the thing that universities have been doing up to now is more seen as training than actual finding solutions. Because let's be clear, it's not about the boards, what they want. It's about the guy that has the pain on a daily basis. And if he can't find a solution, he has his boss saying, look, guy, I want to see an increase of 20% in your numbers by the end of the year. And the person is trying to find solutions to actually have that increase, because otherwise there's no bonus at the end of the year, which means more and more they need a speedy possible solution for that challenge, which means you have to go for startups that are more advanced, more mature, they're not going to die tomorrow, and they're actually producing a solution that's already being sold in the market. Maybe they need to change a little bit the solution for the challenge that that corporate is asking, maybe add a feature or two, but the fact that they want is really pilot very quickly that's a solution, experiment if it works, add on whatever needs to be added on. And then if it works after 3 months, let's move forward to contract and getting this working, because we need to move on to the next challenge. So I think it's very important that the universities think, do I want to train the students? And in that respect also help train the way the corporates think, or do I want to find solutions, real solutions for corporates?
And Ricardo, sorry for the interruption. I actually want to build on that, because challenge-based learning is growing and coming up as another methodology where a lot of universities are experimenting with, where you're basically throwing a challenge, working for a whole semester, sometimes a year, with a corporate on that specific challenge, and the students work on developing the product or solving the problem, working with the company and developing the product or solution at the end. Have you had experiences with that? What are your thoughts on it?
Look, I think it's interesting to do with the students, but I think there's it can't be just a corporate and the students. Probably if you want to really go for solutions, because otherwise what you're going to get is a report at the end and some measures of, how we could move forward. The students are not yet prepared to go for, I'm not saying it's impossible, but what I'm saying is, it's very hard to get real solution out of this. So why not add the innovators to the mix? and bring in the corporate, the startups or the innovators inside this one semester, for instance, work with the university. I mean, even now with the pandemic, I mean, we can be anywhere in the world and work on this. So you can have startups from anywhere in the world that are the best ones to actually solve the solution. And maybe the students will also help the startup by engaging on more research or more data or more insights that could be interesting for the startup that's in the market and selling. And for the corporate, it drives to a level where you actually go for something concrete that will solve an issue instead of just, again, having corporates working with the students. And yes, it's interesting for the student mostly, I would say, because for the corporates, it's more of a PR exercise than actual engagement with the staff of the corporate and the real solution that comes out. I'm trying to be as honest as possible because we've seen many of these examples over the years, and most of the results, I mean, even for us, being completely honest, even when we present a corporate with a very mature startup and we try to do a pilot, about 50%, 60% of the times, it fails. So imagine if you're working with students. So why not add in some more expertise by bringing in the innovators and the startups to actually develop something concrete? And even for the students, it could be a great opportunity for them to understand that world of the startups. And maybe even, okay, this student was amazing. The startup will say, look, do you want to come in and work with us? And after, maybe they're finishing university, and it's a great way for them to enter the job market.
Fantastic. Ricardo, let me shift the discussion to a third angle, which I think is very interesting. You worked with Singularity University to bring them to Portugal, and Singularity University is a very unique and interesting kind of organization that looks at the future, scouts the future for new innovations that cuts across disciplinary borders, that brings innovations, AI to the mix, and try to think with people, with leaders, actually about that future. If you can tell us for a couple of minutes about your experience in Singularity University, and then I want to ask you dig a little bit deeper on that. And I think we've got probably less than 5 minutes, so would love to conclude on that thought.
Yeah, I mean, Singularity started about 10 years ago. Peter Diamandis and Rick Herzl and US started it, and basically looking at the future and how the intersection of different industries and technologies will impact the world in the next 10, 20, 30 years. So by bringing this knowledge and by bringing the insights of what could happen and provide them to typically leadership teams or executive boards or in the executive education kind of space, then you open up the possibilities for the leaders in the organizations to actually think about what will be the future of my organization, or where should I look at, or what kind of experiments I should be doing to actually think about that future of my organization.
And you've seen a lot of those sessions and discussions thinking about the future. I want to project some of the thinking of Singularity University to the higher education space. What are your thoughts about what should be or is or may happen in that space with all the technologies that we're seeing evolving about us, whether we're talking the next 5 years, 10 years?
Yeah, I mean, yeah.
Or so. So very curious to hear your perspectives on higher education.
But you mean how these kinds of things could actually evolve into the higher education and how it could change?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Well, I think it could be interesting. I mean, just to be clear, the Singularity University was brought not only by us, BTI, but also with Cascais Municipality and the Nova University. So it's amazing that the university already thought about the possibility of thinking about this future by bringing the project inside their university. So Nova uses also these courses at the executive education space that they have. Now, I do believe that this can also be used at the on the higher education and how you think the processes of bringing new, especially new technology, which, I mean, in the era of the pandemic, we actually saw a huge spike on technology being used at the higher education level. And we also saw that there's still a lot to be done to actually provide something that we could say, this is good. I mean, there's a bunch of platforms that have been doing this for a number of years, and they got a lot of things right, but especially at the university level. And you see the amount of experimenting and the amount of changes that universities are doing every time they experiment something, and maybe something wasn't working, and then the students give feedback that they want maybe another platform or maybe another way of doing things. That goes to say that the universities were not ready for this. A lot of universities were not ready for this. And so, and also, I mean, the students didn't sign up to actually do online courses. So they signed up to do face-to-face, which of course, this is our weird times. But I think maybe a blend of this will stay for the future. And that means we have to improve how the universities look at technology, and also how other sectors are using this technology. And not only that, but I think it's very important that you bring knowledge from outside. So if you are thinking outside of the box, how does a nomad work? How does a remote worker work typically in a company that has been doing this for many years, and maybe they even were born remote? How do you bring those insights and that knowledge inside the university, so that even if you're thinking of continuing, of course, to do face-to-face, there are good things about the online learning. And there are things that could be introduced into a blended face-to-face online. So I think that's that kind of conversation needs to be done also with outside people that there are doing interesting ways on the technology parts that come from completely different industries. I mean, it's like the extreme user, and how do you bring in the knowledge from that extreme user into your organization?
Fantastic. I think as we come to the closure, this has been a very, very rich discussion, Ricardo. Thank you so much for it.
Thank you.
The key learning that I got out of it is that if we look outside in whether the corporate or the entrepreneurial space, the way people work is changing. We're seeing people working remotely. We're seeing people working in international teams. We're seeing people working across different countries and cultures. We're seeing people working their work cuts across different disciplines. We're seeing knowledge becoming obsolete quickly and everybody needing to reskill themselves. We're seeing a need for change, behavioral changes. All of these things are happening. And I think as universities, we probably need to respond in terms of the way that we also teach and learn beyond the classroom. And Ricardo, you mentioned four different ways that I think would be very useful, starting from things like the European Innovation Academy programs where youth get together and work. We didn't get a chance to talk a lot more about the startup acceleration program, but they're becoming more common, talking about challenges and challenge-based learning and bringing large problems from large companies into the university and the classroom, and then using a future-oriented thinking like Singularity University, whether in executive education or even bringing some of that thinking to the university itself. So I think those are really wonderful ideas that we all need to think about, and think about how universities evolve and grow and change in those times and respond to those types of changes that are happening about around us. Thank you so much, Ricardo.
Thank you.
Thank you, everybody, for your attention, and we conclude this session.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you.